Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship at East Livingston Baptist Church. A very wonderful day to be here, and I'm glad that you're able to join us. We're going to begin with that hymn that Norma is playing. It's called Praise the Lord, the King of Glory. You'll find it on page 232 in the hymnal. We'll sing all three verses as we begin our service this morning. Thank you, Tori. There it is. So we'll sing all verses, and please stand and let me hear those voices as we praise the Lord this morning. Praise the Lord, the King of Glory, gracious Son of God is He. Long foretold by prophets holy, great in power and majesty. With the Father through creation, heaven and earth now sing His fame. Hope of joy of every nation, life and light are in His name. Blessed are Heavenly Father, as we come into your house this morning, this is the prayer of our heart. This is the song we lift to you this morning. Praise the Lord, the King of Glory. For God, you have blessed us with your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior now and forever and ever. So as we come together for worship, we have this prayer in our heart and this song on our lips. Speak to us this morning from your heart to ours, O God. Draw us together as the body of Christ. Inspire us and lead us in our spiritual growth as we come together to worship you this day. Hear us now, Lord, for we join our voices and we pray together the prayer that we learned from your Son, Jesus, when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Take a moment now to greet one another.
We're
right, everybody, let's start to pull it back together here. We're very happy that you could all make it out this morning. Little Destin is happy you were here. That's Dexter Wilson's little daughter watching us down in the nursery. Yeah, all right. But we're happy to have you, and welcome to the service this morning. You can register your attendance with those booklets. We appreciate that. And Tori, let's go and see what's going on this week. Oh, there's Violet. It's her day, you know. Today is the fourth Sunday of the month, and just in case you don't remember these things, we have two Sundays each month where we invite you to bring donations to share with the community. On the fourth Sunday today, we collect for Joseph's Coat a community clothes closet. So those in-season or gently used clothes that you have, you can bring them to the church on the fourth Sunday of every month. And Dexter, one of our deacons, takes those over to Joseph's Coat, and they give them away for free in the community. So we do that every month. And that's just a reminder. The second Sunday of every month, we collect food to give to the Reynoldsburg Helping Hand Food Pantry. So the second and the fourth Sundays, you can bring your donations of food or clothing. That goes on throughout the year. But today is the day we are going to celebrate the retirement and the service of Violet Rary as the secretary here at the church. The reception today is following the service, so you're all invited. It's a luncheon down in the fellowship hall. So please, when we're finished with our service of worship, join us in the fellowship hall for lunch today as we honor our honoree. And Violet's here, so that's a good thing. Hi, Violet. Now, when you go into the fellowship hall, everyone, don't sit in the table that has the balloons. Guess who gets the table with the balloons? Yeah, our guest of honor. So the decorations are beautiful, and there's a cake and lunch. So we'll have a great time celebrating after church today. So I think those are the announcements. You can check your bulletin and the website if you want to keep up on how things are going. But let's get right to our music, because... So during Lent, and today is the second Sunday in the Lenten season, we're focusing on Jesus and all that he's done for us, and the songs also reflect that. So this song this morning is all about Jesus, who is the cornerstone. And you'll love the words as we go through. We've sung this before, but especially I like the line, "Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all." Jesus is our cornerstone in the good times, but especially in the bad times. We have a cornerstone in Jesus. So we'll sing Cornerstone this morning. So if you'll stand and follow the words that Tori will share with you, we start with Jesus, who is our hope. My hope is built on nothing less than trust the sweet Since our ushers are ready, let me invite them to come forward to receive this morning's tithes and offerings. We lift our thanks and our praise and our offerings with our music. We do so also in our giving. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we feel blessed because you have touched our hearts and touched our lives. And this morning, as we worship you and lift our praises to you, we bring now these gifts, and we ask, God, that you would touch them and bless them as we offer them to be used so that others might find their way to you and know your love and your forgiveness and your salvation. So I ask your blessing on each of these gifts, on each one who gives, and we ask, God, that you will use them to further the gospel, for we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. All right, boys and girls, time for a junior church, so we want to go ahead and take a moment. Thanks to Karen Vreeland, who's our leader this morning, and all of the kids up through our second grade. We have such a wonderful group of kids, and they get to continue their worship and learning about Jesus in our junior church program. As we go to our prayer time, thank you, Norma. She was playing for who?
Billy Graham.
Yeah. How many times have you heard "Just As I Am" at the end of Billy's services? Linda and I sang in the choir with Cliff Barrows in 1993. Remember, Billy was in town in 93. And we were pastoring at East Baptist over on Broad Street, so some of you were probably involved in that time. So, yep, heaven has gained an angel this week. But my goodness, 1918 to 2000, well, that's a long life. Almost 100 years. Anyway, we thank God for Billy. He'll be lying in state, I believe, on Wednesday and Thursday in Washington in the Rotunda, which is a great honor. And I say he deserves it, all the good that he did over the years, starting in the late 40s. So, but we pray for his children and grandchildren as they say goodbye this week. I had some great news from Edwin Hayes as Serena went in for her surgery on Friday. Thank you for your prayers. She went in about 11 o'clock or so Friday morning, and by around 3:30, he said, praise the Lord, she did great. She came through her surgery just fine. She was in recovery. And one of the things he said that any parent can, you know, relate to, he said, oh, it's over. You know, whew, because this was kind of the surgery kind of came on them quickly. So thank you for your prayers. And now we pray for recovery time, that Serena gets through recovery, gets her strength back, gets home, and can get on with just being a little girl. You know, so. As always, when you come to church, you have prayers on your hearts, some requests, some thanksgiving, some praises. The idea is that we take all of those prayers to the Lord in our prayer time. So let me invite you to join me in prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we do calm and still our hearts at this time that we might focus on you, that we might relish in your presence as you have promised when we gather in your name that you are here in our midst. So we know through your Holy Spirit that you are here with us as we lift our hearts in prayer. We honor you and glorify your name as we pray. We acknowledge you as our God, your Son as our Lord, your Spirit as our sustainer each day through your power. We recognize that all laud and glory goes to you and belongs to you. So, Lord, please accept our praises and our worship as we honor you this morning as we come to this time of prayer. We thank you, God, for your blessings, for the blessing of being able to come and meet together with the family that is the congregation here at East Livingston Baptist, part of the body of Christ that meets around the globe on the first day of the week. We come into your house on this Lord's Day, and we thank you for that opportunity to grow in our faith and to encourage one another, to pray with and for one another. We thank you for this season of Lent that reminds us of the sacrifice that your Son made for us. For it slows us down a little. It lets us focus on the cross in a very special way. And all of that, God, helps us to grow in our faith, to trust in you more, to be more grateful for your many blessings in our life. And we thank you, Lord, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who went to that cross that we might find abundant living here through our connection with you, that we might live daily with the living hope of an eternity with you. Lord, our hearts are full of thanksgiving whenever we turn to you for your goodness to us and for your presence here in our midst. Lord, we do lift up to you those who have needs and concerns on their hearts this morning. For, Lord, life can be stressful, and it brings us experiences where we really depend upon you. In our prayer this morning, God, we give you thanks for the life and the ministry of the Reverend Dr. Billy Graham. There's very few of us whose lives haven't been impacted by his ministry. And we're grateful, along with Christians around the world, for his willingness to follow your call to be an evangelist and a preacher and to share the good news in such a common sense way where we could understand it. We pray for his family this morning as they prepare for funerals and for saying goodbye. We ask for your strength, as always, for that the Graham family. But we thank you, God, that Billy's legacy will live on for years and years among those of us who were touched by his ministry. And Lord, it's a reminder to each of us that you do the same with us. As we plant the seeds of your gospel, there is a legacy for years to come. I pray for any this morning who are dealing with health issues. We pray for those in the hospital, some who have just had surgery. We pray for those undergoing tests or going through therapies or taking medications under a doctor's care. Some would like to be with us this morning but need to stay home. We remember all of them. We pray for those who are in nursing care facilities this morning. We love them and we know that you love them, God. Even though we can't all be together, we know that you know where each of these loved ones are and that you are with them through your Spirit. We thank you for that. We ask your blessing on them. We pray, God, you will continue to be with us as a congregation as we look to you for leadership, as we look to you for vision, as we thank you for the ministry of the past, and we trust in you for the ministry of the future. And then we thank you for these moments together this morning, God, for you are meeting with us and speaking into our hearts the words that we need to hear. So we pray our scripture will come alive to us this morning, that our faith will be encouraged, that we'll grow closer to you because we have come together this day. I ask, Lord, that you hear all of our prayers. I lift some with my own voice, but there are many prayers coming to you this morning from the hearts of each and every one of us. We thank you that you hear all of those prayers, Lord, and we definitely lift them to you this day. So God, hear our prayers as we offer them gratefully, as we offer them with confidence, as we offer them in the spirit of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came and gave his life, who sent and gave us the Holy Spirit to sustain us. So hear our prayers, accept them as we lift them to you. For we pray in Jesus' precious name, amen. Our scripture reading today is in the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark. So if you'd like to follow along, just take out your smartphone, dial up your Bible app. I usually say, take out the Bible in the pew or your own Bible. But last week when Jane Gibbons was here, and thank you all for being so nice to my friend Jane. She enjoyed her time with you, and she's going to be working with you in the coming months. So that was awesome. But I was sitting on the front row, and Jane said, here's my scripture. And I didn't have a Bible next to me there. My Bible was up here. So then I thought, wait a minute, I got my phone. Now, the trick is you have to turn the ringer off, right? Mm-hmm, yeah. Right, boys and girls? We turn the ringers off. Yeah. Like a second grade teacher, right, Norma? We turn our ringers off when we come to church. But yeah, the phone app came up. It was awesome. So some of you might be using your electronic devices to follow the Word of God. That's pretty cool. I'm going to read from this old-fashioned book here. But our scripture is Mark 14. The passage starts at verse 43 and goes down through verse 50. Just as he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, appeared. With him was a crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests the teachers of the law and the elders. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard. Verse 45. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, Rabbi, and kissed him. The men seized Jesus and they arrested him. Then one of those standing near drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Am I leading a rebellion, said Jesus, that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I was with you, teaching in the temple courts, and you did not arrest me. But the scriptures must be fulfilled. Then everyone deserted him and fled. And may God bless to our heart the reading of this portion of Holy Scripture this morning. So during the season of Lent, I'm going to be leading you through a Lenten series this year. It's called Lenten Sacrifices. Thank you, Jesus. You'll see that in the bulletin each week. Because during the Lenten season, we think about the sacrifices that Jesus made for our salvation. So this year I got thinking about that, and when we think about Jesus' sacrifices, we think of him going to the cross and giving his life, because that sacrifice just overwhelms us anytime we think about it. But the more I thought, there were other sacrifices that Jesus made throughout his ministry. We may not notice them as much. We may not think about them as much. So in my series, we're going to highlight some of the other sacrifices that Jesus made on his way to the cross. And as we think of the sacrifices that he made, we're going to thank him. Thank you, Jesus, for being willing to make that sacrifice. So the Lenten series, Lenten Sacrifices, thank you, Jesus. Now today, the message says, standing alone, we're thanking Jesus for being willing to stand alone. That is getting at the idea that he sacrificed his relationships in this world. Just yesterday, Linda and I had Glenn and Evan and their wives, Brittany and Olivia, at our house. It was wonderful to see them. It always is. And lately, as we've been doing since the wedding on December 1st, we always find a way to look at some wedding pictures. And when I talk about wedding pictures, I think there's somewhere in the number of 6,000 to 7,000, something like that. There's a lot of wedding pictures because it's all digital now, so they don't have to spend money on film. So boom, 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 boom. There's a lot of them. And they're all just wonderful. So we're looking at some of those yesterday, and I was struck by the friendships that both Olivia and Evan had. Were there 10 in the wedding party? Somewhere in that neighborhood. 10 men and 10 women. So, you know, it was a big wedding party. And Evan and Olivia had relationships with all of these. Some of them, they were friends from childhood. Some, they were friends from high school. Some from college. But they were connected to all of these people. And they just had a ball. They just, even if they didn't know each other from, you know, how they were connected to the bridal couple, they enjoyed each other's company. And as I was thinking about this, I'm realizing they're going to have these pictures their whole life. They're not just going to look at them a couple months after. And when they look back, they're going to remember their friends and how important those friendships have been to them. And I can relate. We can all relate about how our friends and those that are close to us, how much they mean to us. Which is why this passage that we just read about Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane has such a bite to it, is so painful. Because Jesus was willing to sacrifice the friends and the disciples and the people that he had gathered around him. He was willing to give all of that up for you and for me. So that's what we're looking at this morning. It's the Garden of Gethsemane, and Jesus has been in the upper room with his disciples. And Jesus kind of knows what's coming, the disciples don't. And now they've come out to the garden to pray. When we have our communion, we always say, well, after they had sung a hymn, they went out of the upper room, and this is where they went. They went out into the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus wanted to have some time to pray, and he's there. He's got now 11. Judas has already gone. But he's got the 11 disciples that he's lived with very closely, you know, for the last 3 years. And they all mean a lot to him, you know, John and Peter and all of the disciples. So they go to the garden, and I can only imagine Jesus was really happy to have them there with him in this hour of his need. So what do? You remember? They fall asleep. Yeah. He gets him to the garden. He's glad to have his, you know, his closest friends, really. And he prays, and when he opens his eyes, they're all asleep. Now, God is good, you know? And most of you stay awake when I'm preaching to you. And I don't have to, you know, feel that. Old Doc Mumper in the church that I grew up in, I don't even know his age. He was one of those people that just was ageless, you know. He could have been 200, I don't even know. But he would sit, I forget where he sat, in the pews in my home church. You could pretty much count every Sunday Doc Mumper was going to be asleep at some point in the sermon. If he wasn't, everyone got a little nervous, you know, like, Because it was just, he got in there and it was nice and comfortable in the voice of the pastor. So here's Jesus, and he's out there in the garden, and his disciples are asleep. Well, Jesus discussed that with them. He addressed it, and he said, can't you stay awake even an hour with me here in the garden? Because as they go to sleep, it just emphasized for him that even though they were there with him in the garden, he was alone. He was alone in that garden. There was a book that was written not too long ago, and I was always fascinated by the title. The title is Bowling Alone. Now, bowling has been around, you know, a long time. And I remember growing up, it was the bowling league, you know? Some of you might even be in leagues now. The thing about the bowling was you'd be with your buddies, you'd be with your friends, you'd be with the others in the league. So now there's a book, and it's called Bowling Alone. It's the title of the book. Because some people now, when they go to bowl, there's no friend, there's no group. They come by themselves. They're bowling alone. And it's a book, it's written by Robert Putman. You could Google it and find it on Amazon, whatever. But the author, Robert Putman, makes a case based on that idea of bowling alone, that loneliness, being isolated from one another, is one of America's new epidemics. He says people are searching for a place to belong. And it's not always there, because we're not connected the way we used to be. I mean, I only have to look at my own upbringing to understand that. In my hometown, the families were together, and everyone, every mom on my street and the street over knew my name and had the authority of my mom to discipline me if I was getting into mischief. And that's the way it was. And all us kids knew it. Georgie! I can still hear that in my brain. If I heard that, it didn't matter who was saying it. It
could have been Mrs. Heffelfinger, could have been Mrs. Arnold. It didn't matter. Any of the moms on the street, they knew I was getting into mischief. And if I heard that, I straightened up right now. That was my upbringing. We have gone through a different way of being connected now. I remember door-to-door salespeople. Now, I don't necessarily belabor the loss of door-to-door salespeople, but the fact that that doesn't happen anymore means you're not sure what's going to happen if you knock on a door now. And there's some tragedy even in that reality. The world has changed. This author, Robert Putman, said back in the 70s, that would be when I was in college, there was a search for identity in America. People were asking, and I do remember this, who am I and why am I here? It was sort of like, hey, baby, you know, peace. I'm trying to find myself. And that was kind of big. The issue, according to this author, of the 21st century has shifted, and now it's where do I belong? And he claims that belonging is a God-given human need that we all need, and we want the security of belonging to a family, belonging to a group, belonging to a team, belonging with people who need us just like we need them in a healthy and in a productive way. But the fragmentation of the family, the rapid growth of technology, have made people much more mobile and isolated than ever. And he ends by saying, the aching need to belong is at an all-time high. So in my own family, knowing that that little street was where everybody knew everybody, we all grew up and started moving out to get jobs because that's how the society was now. Some of the Rust Belt jobs disappeared in the north, so people were moving south to get other jobs, and my family spread out from South Carolina to Oklahoma to Florida and to Ohio, and we weren't all on that street anymore. So this author says, as this fragmentation and technology have made us all more mobile, it's also brought in a time where we're more isolated. Jesus' disciples, they just weren't able to stay awake with Jesus that night in Gethsemane. And it underscores that Jesus was alone. But I tell you, what comes next in this passage makes your skin crawl. The soldiers arrive, you know. Judas turns him over to them. And in one of the most ironic moves in history, he betrays him with a kiss, which is normally, I love you. But he's betrayed by that kiss that night, his own disciple turning against him. And after the soldiers have Jesus now in custody, verse 50 records what happens next. Then everyone deserted him and fled. So now they're not just asleep. Now they are gone. Yeah. They deserted him, which means, you know, Peter saying, I don't know him. And then they fled. They got out of the garden. Jesus looks around, and there's no one there but the soldiers holding him by the arms. It just is something that takes your breath away. I mean, wow, talk about sacrificing friendship and sacrificing relationship. There in the garden with the soldiers taking him away, all of those who were with Jesus deserted him and fled into the night. So we're talking about what Jesus sacrificed during the Lenten season, and, you know, here we see clearly how Jesus sacrificed all of his relationships, the support of his friends and his disciples, all of it, in order to be able to extend to me and to you the gift of our salvation. And of course, ultimately, Jesus was even separated from his Father. So just when we think it can't get any worse, all have deserted him and fled, it does get worse. Jesus quoted from the cross the beginning of Psalm 22. And it seemed really interesting to me this week as I looked at Psalm 22, these words I'm going to share come right before Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The 23rd Psalm that brings us so much comfort. Right before it come these words. Verse 1 in Psalm 22 says, my God, why have you forsaken me? And Jesus quotes that from the cross. Now this is a loneliness that you and I will never know. As I read some more of the verses in Psalm 22, I was amazed at how it describes what Jesus went through on the cross. Verse 7 in Psalm 22, all who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. Verse 16, dogs surround me, a pack of villains encircle me. They pierce my hands and feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them, and they cast lots for my garment. Now, these words were written 1,000 years before Jesus was ever born. But does that not describe what happened to Jesus on the day of his crucifixion? And Jesus knew that, and he quotes it from the cross, as if to say, if you want to know what's happening to me, look at your Bible, and you'll find out. At the end, Jesus was alone. He sacrificed all of his relationships. He did that for us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, you understand our loneliness. You ever thought about that? When we're lonely, Jesus understands that loneliness. Because Jesus allowed himself to stand completely alone. He knows how you feel on those days when the loneliness gnaws at your heart. Fast forward, though, with me to Jesus after the resurrection. Jesus is once again with his disciples. He is very much alive. And they're still trying to take it all in. They saw him crucified, but he's been with them now. And he says to them on that side of the resurrection, go now and make disciples of all nations. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Thank you, Jesus. You see this? We don't have to stand alone. Jesus did, but then he makes it so that we do not have to. Jesus promised to be with all of us as we follow him in faith, even until the end of the age. Jesus stands alone, so we don't have to. So as Billy Graham, as the news of his passing came through the media this week, I heard some of his sermons on the radio. I looked up some of his devotions. We used one in our Wednesday night Bible study. I've been touched again by his ministry. There was a sermon that Billy Graham preached in Anaheim, California back in 1985. For me, that was a good year. That's the year Linda and I were married. And Anaheim, California, 1985. And the title of this sermon Billy preached was Loneliness. One word title, loneliness. And I heard some of that sermon on the radio, and it really grabbed me. So I looked it up a little bit more and saw that toward the end of that sermon, Dr. Graham made the point And I just want to share that with you today. I want to leave it with you. Because in Billy Graham's sermon, he said this: Jesus Christ experienced the greatest loneliness the world has ever known so that we would never have to be lonely again. That's a beautiful sentence. It's not that we won't experience the loneliness that comes along in life. We all experience that. We all find ourselves in solitude from time to time. We find ourselves in sorrow and feeling the loneliness of grief and sorrow. These are part of the human experience for all of us. It's not that we won't experience that kind of loneliness, but we will never have to be lonely in the way that Jesus was. As he traveled his journey, it truly was a lonely journey to the cross of Calvary. For our Savior, as we can see, sacrificed all of his relationships. He sacrificed his friends and his family and his disciples and ultimately even his Father, in order that he could carry our sins. He could carry my sins. He could carry your sins to the cross. And he gave his own life so that we would never have to stand completely alone as he did. Because wherever we are and whatever we are doing, as we live for Jesus, we are never alone. But we have Christ with us, in our heart, in our mind, in our church, in our life, from now until the end of the age. Thank you, Jesus. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we look back today on the sacrifice that your Son Jesus made, it is difficult as we realize what he gave up. And today, as we see him in the garden and on the cross, we realize he had to stand alone in order to take our sins. Lord, this morning we are so grateful. We do say thank you that that sacrifice was willing to be paid. God, I just ask that you remind us that when we place our faith and trust in you, when we follow you in faith each day, you are never going to leave us alone, no matter what is happening, no matter what earthly loneliness we may experience. You are always going to be with us. You've given us that promise, and we live it each day. So we thank you for that promise and that assurance, for that reality in our life. We pray that it would help us to be more faithful to you, to be stronger witnesses for you, to be willing to do what you call us to do. For we do it all in Jesus' name. Amen. So our closing hymn you'll find on page 65 this morning. And the title says, "Just When I Need Him Most." And the he is Jesus. Just when I need Jesus, he's near. Especially when we need him most, he's right there to comfort and to cheer. The hymn picks up on the meaning of this text, that even though Jesus was alone, he's always with us, and we're never without him, especially when we need him most. And that is a hymn that becomes our own testimony. We thank God for being with us, and we share it with the world, and we say, if you only would have Jesus Christ in your heart, you would know that you're never alone either, because God has promised to be with us forever and ever. So this is our closing hymn this morning. It is a hymn of commitment, a hymn of testimony. If you're here and you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, never taken that first step. We always want to encourage you to make that move in your own life. You'll never be sorry. We'll sing the first and the last verse of this beautiful hymn as it expresses what God has shown us. When we need Jesus most, he's right there with us, and we thank him for that blessing. Norma, if you would, let's stand. We'll sing the first and the last verse. Just when I need him, Jesus is near. Just when I falter, just when I fear, ready to help me, ready to cheer. Just when I need him most, just when I need him most, just when I need him most, Jesus is near to comfort and cheer. Just when I need him most, just when I need him, he is my all, answering when I fall in my call, tenderly watching lest I fall. Just when I need him most, just when I need him most, just when I need him most, here to comfort and cheer, just when I need him most. So remember, you're all invited to join us in the fellowship hall after our benediction to honor Violet this morning. But receive now our benediction. And may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your heart this day and strengthen you in every good deed and word. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.